How do you choose the best ETF to invest in, and how do you build a strong portfolio? Well, the most common method you will hear is diversification. Allocating a portion of your portfolio towards growth investments that are focused on capital appreciation, like technology stocks, and another portion focused on value investments that are defensive and are most commonly accompanied with a dividend, like financials, healthcare, and consumer goods. These sectors complement each other very well, providing both exponential growth potential, downside risk mitigation, and a dividend. And then of course, there's other categories like fixed income, bonds, and high income strategies like covered call ETFs for income-oriented investors. But here's the thing, within these individual sections of a portfolio, it's really important to maintain a clear distinction between your growth and value strategies to achieve the best performance outcomes. You see, there are so many ETFs out there that are meant to do the same thing. For example, there's a multitude of growth-focused ETFs, and they differ in minor details, but those little details long-term can make such a big impact on your returns, and they may not even be evident until you do some digging. So this brings me to my main topic. How do you find ETFs that are the best fit for the different components of your portfolio, and what kind of things should you avoid? There are many ETFs out there that have so much assets under management, with billions of dollars of investors' money, and yet they are clearly inferior investments compared to their category. So I wanted to focus on one of the most popular ETFs on the market today that may have investors fooled. And this is where things get really interesting. SCHG. This is a Schwab US Large Cap Growth ETF. Now, I know this ETF is very popular, and I've seen many people in the comments praising SCHD, saying that it is the perfect complement to SCHD, truly a growth and value combination to hold on to. Not only that, but you can also find a variety of articles praising this ETF as well. I will say there is one secret benefit about this ETF that investors can take advantage of, so you're gonna wanna stick around until the end. So let's run through the fundamentals so you can get a better understanding of this ETF. This ETF was established on December 11, 2009. It is a well-known ETF with a very long track record. The fund currently has $20 billion of assets under management. It also has an extremely low expense ratio of only 0.04%. That is one of the lowest expense ratios you can find in an ETF. So that is one major benefit. And just for reference, for every $10,000 invested, you only pay $4 in annual fees. The expense ratio is not something that you pay for directly. It is a fee that is taken out of the fund every year. And currently, the fund managers are collecting $8 million per year in fees. That is a lot. So how does this fund work? Well, it's very simple. This ETF is linked to the Dow Jones US Large Cap Growth Total Stock Market Index, which offers exposure to large cap companies within the growth sector of the US equity market. And the fund currently holds 245 individual stocks, so it is well diversified. Now, based on this information, you'd think that this is the perfect investment for the growth section of your portfolio. I mean, the title could not be more self-explanatory. And when you look at the fund's holding breakdown, you can see that almost 45% of the fund's assets are allocated towards the technology sector, with its second highest allocation of 13% in healthcare, 13% in communications, 12% in consumer cyclical, and 6% in financials. This section right here is what I want you to focus on because something isn't quite right. Now we'll circle back to it in just a second. Looking at the fund's individual holding breakdown, you can see that the heaviest allocations are in Apple and Microsoft, with Nvidia, Amazon, Google, and Tesla in its top six holdings. So this is very typical amongst other growth-oriented ETFs, heavy allocation towards tech, including the big six. Year to date, the fund has appreciated by 37%, which is fantastic, outperforming the S&P 500, which has returned 18%. And since inception, the fund has appreciated by 575%. But now let's take a look at the QQQ. The QQQ is one of the most popular ETFs for growth investing. It consists of 100 of the largest domestic and international non-financial companies listed on the NASDAQ based on market capitalization. Year to date, the fund has appreciated by 41%, outperforming SCHD. And since inception, using the inception date of SCHD to keep things consistent, QQQ has returned almost 900%, significantly outperforming SCHD. But how come? Why is SCHG underperforming by such a significant amount? Well, this is where things get really interesting. Now, before we continue, let's take a brief moment to talk about today's sponsor, Aura. If you're like me and you're tired of constantly receiving spam phone calls to the point where you don't even answer if the contact isn't saved to your phone, Aura is the perfect solution. Many data brokers out there are making a fortune selling your information to spammers and robocallers. Some even get access to your personal information, like your living address. Aura can identify data brokers exposing your information and submit opt-out requests on your behalf. On top of that, Aura does so much more to protect your family from online threats that you wouldn't normally catch. It's really easy to set up and you don't have to download several different apps. You get it all in one place and at a super affordable price. It comes with parental controls, antivirus, VPN, password management, identity theft insurance, and so much more. So let Aura do the hard work of keeping you safe online so you can focus on your tasks with a peace of mind. Go to aura.com/Victoria, start your 2-week free trial, and check if your personal information has been compromised. You can also find the link in the description down below. Now back to the video. If you look at the holding breakdown of SCHG and QQQ side by side, you see two major differences. SCHG has almost double the allocation in healthcare and 10 times the allocation in financials. Although, the QQQ should have zero allocation in the financial sector. Are these sectors growth-oriented or value-oriented? Well, for one, financials is definitely not a growth sector by any means. It is a value sector. Financial stocks often have lower price-to-earnings ratio and price-to-book ratio compared to stocks in growth sectors like technology. Many financial institutions also have a history of paying dividends, which is also a key component in value investing. So SCHG's 6% allocation towards the financial sector definitely doesn't fit the fund's title or goal, which is large cap growth. Now moving on to healthcare. This one's a little tricky because healthcare can fit in both the growth and the value sector, and it really just depends on the individual stock. This chart right here shows the performance of the different sectors in the stock market in varying time frames. And you can see that healthcare is consistently lagging behind almost every other growth sector in the market, especially the technology sector. And this chart shows the performance of the different sectors in the stock market over the last 7 recessions. For example, in 2022, the healthcare sector did not suffer nearly as much as the technology sector. Plus, many healthcare stocks provide strong dividend yields. So you may be saying, well, there's nothing wrong with having investments in these sectors. It provides better diversification. And yes, that is true, but at what cost? SCHG does not have any better risk mitigation than the QQQ. In the bear market of 2022, both ETFs suffered just as much, with SCHG losing 32.4% and the QQQ losing 33.2%. Even given the heavier allocation towards healthcare and financial stocks, which tend to have dividend yields, you'd think that you would get a higher yield than the QQQ. Well, SCHG actually has a lower dividend yield at only 0.45% versus 0.58%. But not only that, the QQQ also has superior dividend growth, with almost an 11% 5-year average growth rate and a 10% 3-year average growth rate, whereas SCHG has shown a negative average growth rate over the last 5 and 3 years. So given all the information, the bottom line is this. SCHG has wasted allocation towards increasing diversification in 2 sectors that don't provide any benefit to the fund's goal, which is growth. These value-oriented investments are too small to provide any risk mitigation or dividend yield, but are large enough to hinder the fund's growth. When an ETF is designed for growth, it should be focused on companies with higher growth potential and higher valuations. Introducing value stocks into the ETF will dilute its growth-oriented focus and potentially hinder its performance. Many investors consider SCHG for the growth portion of their portfolio, but I feel that it may be doing more harm than good and you are missing out on significantly more growth potential. Now, there is of course 2 major components we have to talk about. Yes, SCHG has a really low expense ratio at 0.04% compared to the QQQ at 0.2%. But even then, despite the higher expense ratio, it has not hindered the performance of QQQ by any significant amount. Plus, you can always look at QQQM, which is practically the exact same ETF, but with a lower expense ratio at 0.15%. So now let's talk about the price. This is, in my opinion, probably the only reason that someone would choose SCHD over other growth ETFs like QQQ or VGT. SCHD has a share price of only around $70, whereas QQQ or VGT are well above $300. Now, in terms of buying shares, it may make a difference only if the brokerage you're using does not allow for fractional share purchases. Although many brokerages do allow it, so that problem can be fixed. The one major benefit of this ETF comes when you decide to trade options, and I'm specifically talking about covered calls and cash secured puts. So the covered call strategy is very well known, and that is when you decide to sell call options against the underlying stock or ETF that you own. Now, for each call option that you sell, you must own 100 shares of stock. Otherwise, you'll be doing what's called naked short selling, which is very dangerous. So for example, if you want to sell two call options against SCHD, you need to own 200 shares of this ETF. Now, given that the price of the ETF is only around $75, you need to have the equivalent of $15,150 in your account. In comparison, if you wanted to sell two call options against your QQQ holdings, given that the price of QQQ on the day of this recording is $372, you need to have the equivalent of $74,400 in your account. That is a major difference. And the same goes for selling cash secured puts. You need to make sure that for every put option that you sell, you have enough cash to buy 100 shares of stock. And the thing is, because SCHD is growth oriented, it has a good amount of volatility that translates to substantially high premiums on the options contracts. And for those who don't know, a stock or an ETF that is susceptible to higher volatility tends to have more premium associated with its underlying option contracts. So if you're an investor that owns SCHD and you're not using the cheap price to sell cash secured puts or covered calls, then you're not using the investment to its full potential. Personally, I wouldn't start by buying the ETF in the first place. I would begin by selling cash secured put options, collect premium, and continue doing so until I get assigned. Now, if I wanted to focus on premium income, then I would start selling call options, doing what's referred to as the wheel strategy. But I will leave that for another video. And that is all for this one. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you in my next one.